Hello, I'm Kelvin Leibold, an Area Farm Management Field Specialist with Iowa State University Extension, based out in north central Iowa, and I'd like to put together today a series of six videos looking at Iowa farm leasing arrangements. If you want to get a hold of me, the email is probably the best way, as I travel quite a bit. The agenda that I have for today is we'll have the first video here take a look at cash rental rates, second one take a look at landlord-tenant communications, third one take a look at legal issues and written leases, fourth one take a look at the update on the farm programs and what those payments mean to rental rates, the fifth one is the cost of crop production, and the last is taking a look at estimating a fair cash rental rate. Grain markets have not been kind to us in recent weeks. We have a world surplus of corn, of wheat, and soybeans, and this has driven all of the markets down lower. So it's a challenge for us. This is the December 2017 futures contract, so that's not the Iowa cash price, which is about 30 cents lower or more in some places. Again, this is the bean chart for November of 2017, taking a look at the downward trend that we've seen in prices. Iowa corn and soybean crop looks to be good. We'll see if it actually is that good when it hits to the combines, but nonetheless, as we move forward here, we hopefully will bottom out soon and start to rally. A lot of land in Iowa, we estimate about 20% is owned by people who live outside the state. Of the land that is in Iowa, over half of it's rented. Again, some interesting dynamics there as we take a look at trying to communicate with out-of-state landowners or even local landowners. It creates some challenges for us. Again, this map, which is the 2012 Census of Ag Data, the USDA, shows that north central Iowa area that I work in, as well as northwest Iowa, being heavily composed of rented land. A large percentage of that, of course, is cash rent. Well, if we take a look at return to owners here, those crop share landowners participated in the rally in prices and the rally in yields, had some pretty outstanding revenues. Now they've seen those revenues decline because of declining grain prices. Yields have remained good, but prices have been a challenge. Cash rent was slower to follow up in the rally, peaked out in 2013, declined in 2014, 2015, and 2016. And will decline again into 2017, the way it looks. The green dotted line refers to those that are a cash rent, but they may have some type of a flex. So we estimate that about 20% of our leases here have some type of a flex component, and that's usually based off of both price and yield. So there haven't been any bonuses paid on those. So the flex might be based off of 30% of the revenue that the operation has. Again, crop share has the advantage that the prices change, the revenue changes with both price and yield. The owner gets to contribute to some of the cost of production, whereas cash rent is locked in, whereas a cash rent plus some type of a bonus on a flex lease, again, allows the landlord to participate in both yield or price. The crop share has some advantages. You get to participate in the upside yields and the upside prices. You get to be involved in the decision-making process and more involved in the grain marketing, typically. And you may get the benefits of some of your tenants' investment in technology or unexpected rallies in the prices. You also probably get more information about the yields and the inputs that are used and the quantity of inputs used. And for some operations, the large operations, the landlord may get actually a second USDA payment, which might be important for those tenants that are large scale. There's some disadvantages. You got to agree on, both of you have to agree on how you're going to deal with production expenses. If you've got buildings, you've got to make decisions about those and the storage and drying, how much chemicals you're going to use, if there's a special application, how is the cost of that application going to have to be split. And generally, I think most people agree on which government program to go into. So again, the decisions about what to do with grain storage, where the grain is going to be stored and who's going to look after it are all issues that need to be considered. The landlord may also want to be what's considered material participating for a variety of reasons. That, however, will subject his income to Social Security taxes, and that may not be desirable for many landlords. It doesn't mean that if you have a crop share lease that you do have to qualify for material participation. Very few actually do. Most landlords prefer not to, and it does allow you some flexibility in trying to figure out which would be the most desirable. We came out with a new spreadsheet, C2-30. It helps you take a look at a crop share lease analysis. You can go in and fill in all the yellow boxes, and it'll generate a report that looks at how the inputs are shared, how the outputs, basically bushels, are shared, and government payments and crop insurance, and help you determine if that's something that you want to look at is or not. So again, crop share lease not for everybody, but it's an opportunity. Again, North Central Iowa is heavily dominated by cash rent, so we've been doing a cash rent survey statewide since 1994. That was initially done by Dr. William Edwards. He's now retired, so don't send your questions to him. We take a look at the way that we do the survey. We ask people who we think are knowledgeable, such as operators and landowners, and really focus in on the professional farm managers and ag lenders, and ask them, what do you think typical land rents are in their county? So we break that down into high, medium, and low. And this last year, statewide, we had over 1,500 responses. So again, predominantly from farm operators, although about a fourth of them from professional farm managers and lenders, and then another fourth from landowners. Well, we break the report down into the 9 crop reporting districts. I work mostly in District 2 and in District 5. But you can see that all through the northern 6 districts, rents really don't vary all that much on a district-wide basis. There's a significant difference between high, medium, and low quality land, and there's some significant differences in the range of rents within those 3 different qualities. You get down into South Central Iowa, a lot more marginal land down there. County corn yields, some of those counties down in the 125, 135 bushel yields. So again, that's just going to depress rents. If you take a look at the crop reporting District 2, peaked out in 2013 at about $295, $300 an acre, declined down to about $240. So we've had 3 years of decline, and I think we'll see a fourth year of decline. Again, rather sharp increase, but not so much on the downside. So we refer to this as rents being sticky. They're easier to get up than they are to get back down. So this has created some challenges for our producers. So we've got 2 new vocabulary words here in 2016. One of those is sticky, and that's the unwillingness of some landowners to lower rents. They may think that tenants made profits in earlier years, and they're still sitting on those, so they were slow to go up, so perhaps they'll be slow to come down. They also, some perceive that the rents, their costs have continued to increase, such as property taxes, as well as their personal expenses, such as health insurance and utilities. And so there's also the sense that maybe somebody down the road might pay a higher rent than what my current tenant is paying. So that's resulted in what we call sticky rents. On the other hand, from the tenant side, we've got what we call burn rate. So if I rent a farm and I lose $100 an acre and I spend another $50 on family living, I'm going through $150 per acre cash. Do that on a couple thousand acres, and pretty soon we've got a $300,000 cash loss. We do that a couple years back to back, and pretty soon our lender starts to notice. So what we currently have is a profit problem that's turning into a cash flow problem that then will become a net worth problem. So again, we'll talk more about communication in the following video, but some real challenges on both sides. landlords who rely on that income stream to provide their living, and tenants who are trying to manage their cash flows in these challenging times. District 5 is pretty similar. It got close to $300 an acre, dropped down in the $240 an acre range. This District 5 would be Des Moines, Polk County area, and some surrounding counties. Well, if we take a look at how much of the gross revenue landlords typically would have gotten, I like to think that landlords get about 32% of the corn revenue and about 42% of the bean revenue. You know, if you average that out, you're in the, 37% range maybe. We've been up closer to 49%, still above 40. Traditionally, landlords have received less of the total pie. If I was talking about 32% of the corn crop, I'd be looking at 180 bushel corn, 60 bushels going to the landlord at $3 a bushel. Maybe that's $180, and then pick up another one-third of the government check, so that'd be another $10. So maybe I can approach close to $200. If I was getting 42% of the bean crop, had a 50 bushel yield, that'd be about 20 bushels going to the landlord. 20 bushels, $9 a bushel, that'd get me $180. Another $10 government check would get me up to $190. So rents are still higher than what the traditional 32-42% split would be for a corn-soybean rotation. As we move forward, I think that those will probably come a little bit closer together, more towards historical numbers. This is just taking a look again at District 5. Very similar pattern. Peaked out at almost 48%, still above 40%, but moving lower. All right, so when we take a look at our rental rate survey, you can go in, and if you see there at the bottom of the page, there's a PDF. You can download the PDF. Maybe you want to stop the video and do that now. And you can turn around and take a look at your county and kind of follow through as we go through the next few slides. So Hardin County in 2016 had 18 responses to our survey. Again, not big numbers, but if I've got bankers in there and farm managers in there, they're seeing multiple leases, so it gives us a pretty good flavor for what's going on. You can compare that with surrounding counties, you can compare that with the district average and get a little bit of a feel. Hardin County last 5 years had 175 bushel corn yield average and a 51 bushel bean average. We think that the crop CSR rating, Corn Suitability Rating Index, that's the measurement that the county tax assessor uses to assess your property taxes. So it's a ranking from 0 to 100, with 100 being the best. Hardin County, we think the crop ground's around 85 CSR. Okay, so taking a look here, we've got the overall rent at about $250. We've got the high in there around 280, and the low quality in there around 225. Give or take a couple dollars. So gives you kind of a flavor there on what those range of the high to low is. And then if you go into the publication within that, it'll give you a range within each of those categories. Now, we've gone in and like I mentioned, corn yields 175 bushels in the county. So we took the county rent, 250, divided it by the county yield, and said, man, maybe we're paying around $1.43 a bushel for our rent for every bushel of corn that we raise. We went back and did the same thing with beans. We said, okay, $250 average county rent divided by 51 bushels means that the tenants are paying about $4.90 of every bushel towards the rent. So with beans right now, if you doubled that, that would get you up to what, about $9.80, so you've got landlords taking about half the rent and not paying any of the inputs on beans at this time. Another way is to look at the quality of the farm. The CSR rating should give us some idea about the quality of land. Again, this is actually the CSR 2 rating index, so I've just taken the $250 and divided it by the 85 CSR rating for the crop ground in the county and come up with about $294 per point. So if your farm was a 70 CSR, you could multiply 70 times 2.94 to maybe get an estimate of a starting point where you could take a look at how your yields compared for the quality. Again, the web soil survey URL is listed across the bottom of your screen. You can go in and see if you can track down your farm on there and map out the fields. Again, we're looking at the CSR rating on the fields, not the rating on the whole farm that might include the pasture or timber ground or even water. Okay, so again, there's a tool for you to use to help determine CSRs if you need it. Another way is to take a look at return on investment. The ISU land value survey last fall said the average land in the county for Hardin County for crop ground was $8,438. Well, if I take and multiply that by a capitalization rate of 3, that means that I've got about $253 that I'd need to get for rent. So we've been hanging around 3% capitalization rate. Looks like we did the same thing for 2016. Okay, so if you want to get more data, you can go to the CARD website. The URL is across the top there of the picture. And so we've gone in and updated all this data, put it online, and you can go in and click on your individual county in Iowa, and then it'll come over here and crank out the high, medium, and low quality rents, and then compare that to the high, medium, and low for the state averages. And it'll also show you how your county ranks compared to other counties in the state as far as overall rents. Again, I'd like to thank you for participating in the video that we have here. There'll be 5 more videos looking at communication and written leases, farm program payments, cost of production, and estimating a cash rental rate.